I'm Andrew Wasson from Creative Guitar Studio. Thanks for tuning in to another one of my guitar lessons. Over the weekend, I had a question that was sent to me from Paul. He lives in Woodridge, Illinois. And he says here, I've been playing guitar for 2 years, and I like the older, original rock and roll from the 1950s. Can you do a basic video lesson discussing the 1950s rock guitar style? Mainly on what the rhythm guitarist is thinking about to create the rhythm riffs, and on the scale that seems to be half major and half minor. I know that the basic scale approach is using pentatonic, but I'm confused on the full 7-tone scale that gets used by guys like Scotty Moore, James Burton, and Chuck Berry. Thanks for reading my question, Paul in Woodridge, Illinois. Well, thanks for writing in, Paul. You know, the late 1940s and early 1950s was a period where we saw the formation of a style drawn out of, I guess you could say, a fusion of country and western with swing as well as some R&B, and it eventually just basically became known as the incredibly well-known style of American rock and roll. Now, in this video lesson, I'll keep things pretty straightforward for guitarists like Paul and some of the other introductory level guitarists like him. And we'll just begin by taking a look at the typical rhythm progression that's used on many of these early recordings, as well as some of the players that dominated the early days and the scales that get used and some of the techniques that get applied. So basically, without wasting any time, let's zoom in on the guitar neck and take a closer look at the style of the early American rock and roll guitar players. Let's begin with the most popular full scale used in the 1950s American rock and roll style, and that would be the dominant seventh scale, otherwise known as the Mixolydian. Take a look at example number one of your handout. We have a full neck layout of the A Mixolydian starting on the 6th string 5th fret. It sounds like this. I think it's important to mention that this scale contains the notes of a major scale, but with one unique twist. It's the seventh tone. It's a G natural in Mixolydian, but whereas if you played the standard A major scale, we have a G sharp. So the scale's basically including an interval off of the seventh degree that gets lowered. And that's the unique step of Mixolydian. Now, you got to remember, too, when this scale is applied in this style, it's used more or less in conjunction with the scales of major and minor pentatonic. So it's also important to really get a good handle on those. So take a look at examples number 2 and number 3, showing the notes in position of both A major and A minor pentatonics. I'll run those through right now for you. So here's example number 2. And here's example number 3, the minor pentatonic. Okay, now, it's important to remember that when you're in the major pentatonic, we're going to see a lot of minor thirds in this style. And when you're in the minor pentatonic, you're going to see a little bit more of the flat 5 note added in. So if you're familiar with blues scale, that's going to be really good for you. You'll find those flat 5 tones on the 5th string at the 6th fret in the key of A, and you'll also find one on the 3rd string at the 8th fret. There's also a nice one found. It's the same interval and same note as that one on 3rd string, but it's on 2nd string as well at the 4th fret. So really great intervals. They come up just tons and tons and tons. Let's take a quick look at example number 4, where we're going to see some of this stuff in action. We're going to go up to the 12th position with this one. We're going to start on 1st string, go 12th fret, over to the 4th string at the 14th, then up to the 2nd string 15th, coming back to 12th. Then we're going to have a double stop idea with a hammer-on. That's going to be at the 2nd and 3rd strings, coming up from 12th fret to 13th. We'll go to the 2nd string, 12th, and then down to the 4th string, 14th fret. Cross over next to the 5th string at the 14th fret, do a slide from 10 to 11, back to the 14th, and then resolve on the 6th string, 12th fret. So that's example number 4. Now, let's shift gears a little bit here and talk quickly about the 12-bar format that's really popular in this 1950s, late 1940s American rock and roll style. Now, the idea here is that it's just like a 12-bar blues pretty much, except a lot of times what we're doing is we're adding in riffs and different kinds of elements around it, mainly based off of the double stop. So to get a good handle on all the different 12-bar formats that are out there, I would first of all say to look at some of the famous tunes, look at some Elvis stuff, look at some solo stuff that was put out by Scotty Moore, do some work with some of the Chuck Berry tunes and so on, and just dig into the style and start seeing how these guys modified your basic 12-bar blues structure to create a lot of the boogie-woogie patterns that they're using in this particular style. Now, let's move on, though, to this two-note chord concept, also referred to many times as double stops. And the use of these double stops is rampant throughout this style. I think it's really important to get a good handle on it. And, of course, you know, you catch it from all the famous guys like Scotty Moore. And even check out the guys in the Bruce Springsteen band. You know, they're using it as well. There's a lot of different artists using this double stop approach with this particular sound. So let's take a look now at the lick in example number 5. It goes like this. A lot of double stops in there, and you can hear that in this lick it really applies a similar double stop style that's used by Chuck Berry, and you know, that whole approach I think is really important in this style. So really dig into it. Check out a lot of the famous songs that are using these boogie riffs, like Rock Around the Clock or Johnny Be Good, of course, by Chuck Berry. And don't forget the long-standing classic hit by Roy Brown called Good Rockin' Tonight. That's a great one where you'll see a lot of this stuff applied. And of course, remember, to really learn a style, you've got to learn a good selection of the songs that make up the hits of the style. That way you'll really get the style together for yourself. To wrap up this lesson on 50s era American rock and roll guitar, let's recap the important elements of this particular guitar style, starting with the importance of the major and minor pentatonics and the use of the color tone between the third degrees. There's that major third and that minor third, the way you float between them and the kind of licks that you generate around them is going to be very interesting, and I highly recommend working on that quite a bit. As well, there's the use of mixolydian mode, which drops the major seventh degree from the major scale down to a flat seventh step, and that produces some great color there. And then, of course, there's the use of double stops, which we talked about when we did the lesson portion of the video. And this can be used all over the place to create all kinds of really cool two-note chord ideas, either in solos or, of course, in your rhythm riffs as well. And also, remember this 12-bar format, really reminiscent of the whole blues structure, but of course there's a boogie-woogie style, an element that's unique to the American rock and roll approach in the 50s, so you'll want to get that down. And, you know, really to nail it all, you got to learn songs. So, you know, through learning the popular tunes, not just of this style, but really of almost really any style out there, that's how you really start to get the essence of a particular style. And if you want to nail this classic American guitar style down pat, of the 1950s, you're going to have to learn tunes, and you're going to have to learn probably a lot of tunes before you really start getting a proper handle on it. Well, anyway, once again, thanks for watching. Have fun working on this stuff. You can download the handout and the MP3 jam track for this lesson over at my website at andrewwasson.com, and you can follow me on Twitter, through Facebook, and on my other guitar blog YouTube channel, as well as on my weekly podcast that comes out on Monday. So links are all in the description box below for you. Take care, everybody, and we'll see you next time. Bye for now.